Good morning friends, so welcome back to the recorded classes of operating system. So today we are going to begin with the last module, that is mass storage systems. The name itself suggests we are going to discuss about the mass storage. The term mass storage indicates that we are going to discuss about the secondary memory or the hard disks. All of us know that in comparison to the RAM storage capabilities, hard disks are capable of storing a huge quantity of information. For example, RAM, we have around 4 GB RAMs, 8 GB RAMs, 12 GB RAMs and 16 GB RAMs. I don't think 12 GB RAMs are available in the market. 16 GB probably now it may be available. However, the standard RAM sizes are 4 and 8 GB now. If you look at the storage capabilities of hard disk, 1 TB, 2 TB, I think even up to 4 TB of storage hard disks are available in the market now. So that is why, since we can store large quantity of information, they are called as mass storage systems. So we are going to discuss about these things. Then you can just go, or let me briefly describe the objectives of this unit or of this chapter, to describe the physical structure of secondary storage devices and its effects on the usage of devices, to explain the performance characteristics of mass storage devices, to evaluate disk scheduling algorithms, to discuss operating system services provided for mass storage including the RAID. So let us begin without wasting any time. Overview of mass storage structure. There are many mass storage structures we use in our daily lives. For example, the first one is hard disk. Then if you are DVDs or CDs also can be categorized as a mass storage. Okay, the first, let us begin with the magnetic disks. Magnetic disks provide bulk of secondary storage of modern computers. These drives rotate at the speed of 60 to 250 times per second. So we are going to understand that in coming slides. Okay. Transfer rate is the rate at which the data flows between the drive and the computer. Positioning time, it is also called as random access time, is the time to move disk arm to the desired cylinder. It is okay, then and for the desired sector to rotate under the disk head, it is called as rotational latency. So we will just see that in the coming slide. So okay, let me discuss now itself so that you may understand. So this is how a disk structure is made up of. You can see these are a typical CD like structures. Okay, you can just imagine them as a CD. Okay, so each one of it is called as a platter. So this is one platter, this is another platter, this is a third platter. Okay, you can see you can store the information on both sides of these platters, and these platters are made up of magnetic material. That is why they are called as magnetic disks. So this is the arm assembly where it holds these read write heads. So you can see this black square, it is called as a read write head. So every platter has got two read write heads. Okay, two read write heads. So the arm, this is also arm. Okay, each one of is an arm which holds the read write head. So both side of the disk can be written, or okay, the information can be written on both sides of the disk, or information also can be read from both sides of the disk. You can see it, this, the central pole is called as a spindle. Okay, then it rotates. Okay, so when it rotates, it also the platters also rotate along with this. Okay, I hope you are understanding me. When this spindle rotates along with the spindle, all the platters also will rotate. Then these platters are divided further into tracks. So, for example, you must have seen many track events in Olympics or any other games. So, the whole ground, I mean, the running area is divided into a number of tracks. So, every athlete should run only in his or her particular track. Okay, if they change the track, then sometimes even they may be debarred from from the games itself. So similarly, the surface of the platter is divided into number of tracks. Again, each track is divided into number of sectors. So you can see here, this whole blue, what you are seeing, strip is basically a track. Again, this track is divided into small sectors. Okay, so if you draw a line from here to here, from here to here, okay, it looks like a cylinder. Okay, are you understanding me? You can see a dotted line this side and dotted line this side. So this is called as one cylinder. This is called as one cylinder. Hope you're understanding me. So, so whenever this read write head, actually it will not touch, there is a very small gap, maybe in terms of micro centimeters or millimeters, not even millimeters, okay, micrometers, nanometers, okay, there will be a gap, okay, between the surface of the platter and to the read write head. So whenever if you that is why we should always carry or care the discs, because if a disc falls, okay, then there is a possibility that this read write head may touch the actual surface of the platter. When a read write head touches the surface of the platter, we generally call it as a head crash. Okay, it is called as a head crash. Then when a head crashes with the surface of the platter, then you cannot use that hard disk anymore. Okay, you just have to throw it. This is so hope you're understanding me. Moving head disk mechanism. Okay, so there is a motor over here. So this spindle is attached to the motor. So whenever the motor rotates along with the motor, the spindle rotates. When the spindle rotates, then all the platters along with the spindle also rotate. So what we are discussing now here is random access time is the time to move disc from disc arm to the desired cylinder. One more information thing I forgot to explain you here. These arms, you can just move these arms, front and back. Okay, I hope you're understanding me. Only you can move the arm, front and back. So these arms are capable from moving here till there, here, okay, from here to here. However, these arms are not capable of moving to the opposite direction of the platter here. I hope you're understanding me. Okay, suppose just imagine the information is here, where exactly I'm pointing now. Then the arm should move backwards, then the arm should move backwards and come to that particular track, then come to that particular track. So this time is called as a seek time. Is the time to move disc arm to that particular cylinder, instead of a track. Obviously, tracks only make the cylinder. So it is the time to move the disc arm to that particular cylinder is called as a random access time, or you can call it as a seek time also. And the time for desired sector to rotate under the disc head, it is called as rotational latency. Basically, seek time plus rotational latency is equal to random access time. Okay, both these together we call it as a access time or random access time. So I hope you understood what is the seek time, the difference between a seek time and a latency. Okay, let me explain it again here. So you have to move this arm backwards or in a forward position. So this time it has to physically move from this point to this point. It is called as seek time. So now it has moved backwards and on a particular track. However, for example here, now so the required information is in this sector. The required information is, or for example in this sector where this arrow is pointing. Now this sector has to rotate and come below this read write head. Remember, whatever sector or a track comes below this read write head, only that portion of information will be either read or written. Okay, so what is a seek time? It's a time to move this read arm to that particular track where the information is there. Then what is a latency? It is a time where that particular sector comes below this read write head. So this sector has to rotate and come below this read write head. This is called as rotational latency. So rotational latency plus seek time is equal to access time. So we will continue in the next video. Thank you.